Hello, CUBE community, and welcome to RSAC 2025. We are live. I'm Jackie McGuire, Practice Lead and Principal Analyst, joined by Analyst in Residence John Oltsik, and I am very happy today to be joined by the CISO of Texas Mutual Insurance Company, John Sapp. Thank you for joining us, John.
Oh, my pleasure. It's glad to be
back. It's nice when we have a practitioner on the show. John was just saying, you know, this is a practitioner, so we're actually going to get some truth and not just marketing.
Yeah, it's, I like to say I'm going to give you the hype, the hope, and the harsh reality.
Yeah, so what are you looking forward to at RSA this year?
You know, I think everything is going to be branded AI of some sort, and that's probably the number one thing here, because it's a priority everywhere, because there's an explosive use of AI everywhere you go, everything you do, no matter what part of life it is. So there's that part of it. But then it's looking at the things in the innovation sandbox and what's emerging in terms of technology from a security standpoint, and how are we collectively as a community going to come together to protect against the adversaries.
I always feel like people don't spend enough time in the villages. I've spoken in the villages a few times, so if you go to DEF CON, if you weren't aware, RSA actually has the same villages at RSA that they have at DEF CON. There's nice. The Dark Arts Village, the Blue Team Village, the Red Team Village, so I feel like people should check those out as well. Would you agree with the sentiment that shadow AI is the new shadow IT? That's what I heard a couple minutes ago.
Yeah, and you know, I don't even know that it's shadow AI anymore. It's just AI everywhere. And you know, it doesn't matter whether it is your coffee maker. You know, I've seen those in the offices where AI, you literally can talk to it and tell it how to make your own frappuccino, iced latte, whatever it may be. But there's AI in everything we do. So it's now, I think it's come out of the shadow, and I guess they're applying kind of the concept of what we did with shadow IT a few years ago. But yeah, it is everywhere, because you know, we think about now there's the growth of agentic AI, and there's an agent of AI that's everywhere that does everything. Mm-hmm. And you know, that's where I'd like to take this conversation into talking about how do we enable the secure adoption and responsible use of AI. Yeah.
That's just what I was thinking, John, because I look at healthcare as just a prime industry for AI. Not only clinicians, but to get into some of the efficiencies, it's a very decentralized industry. It's 17% of GDP. So what are you seeing in your domain that's interesting or even scary for
a security person? You know, I actually had a podcast with some folks maybe about a month ago, and we were talking about this very thing. And it is, you think about AI being used in terms of making diagnosis and you know, the things that go into that, how much more efficient or how many more things could be discovered sooner, because AI does have the capacity to kind of help with identifying or connecting the dots where maybe a surgeon or a doctor may not be able to. You know, I think about years ago when I was working at McKesson here in San Francisco, we were working on this thing of the concept of a longitudinal patient health record. You know, imagine connecting all of your different doctor records together so you could literally identify any patterns. So imagine AI being used to look across your longitudinal patient health record to maybe identify something that a doctor missed, that maybe something from your dentist tied in with something you know, your other doctors may not have seen. Yeah. So I think there's that, there's the diagnosis part, there's the efficiency in processing claims.
I was just going to mention that, like the ability to go vertically as well, because I think so my first adult job was actually at the mental health and substance abuse subcontractor for Blue Cross Blue Shield. So I did a lot of claims processing, and our first attempt at automating claims processing went really wrong, right? There were a lot of very chronically ill people who were denied care, and it was, you know, had to appeal. So for me, AI would enable kind of a more personalized automation of claims. So if you can go vertically within the person and say typically, you know, make those decisions that are actually long-term more profitable for the insurance company to keep people healthy, rather than just being like, for the average person, this service isn't needed. Because that's something as someone who suffers from a chronic illness myself, it would be really nice not to have to justify everything I need that normal people don't need.
Right. Yeah, and you know, you make a great point there. But now we also have to think about the other side of it, because there's always where there is, you know, some good, there's some bad that can come out of it. You know, there are risks associated with it. you know, for years, you know, WebMD became kind of the go-to thing for people to kind of self-diagnose, right? And so now, maybe you start applying AI into WebMD, and now you start to provide recommendations to, you know, the patient or the individual that's doing the searching. And now the question becomes, is there liability associated with that? So, you know, that's why I talk about the secure adoption and responsible use. Because we, you know, we can't make any of this foolproof. Mm-hmm. You know, there does have to be a bit of common sense applied to it. Yeah. You can't just say, well, AI produced it, because, you know, we know there are hallucinations, so we have to be cognizant of that. But I think the good outweighs the bad. It's just hopefully the litigious society that we live in doesn't ruin it for us.
And what about regulations? Because you're healthcare is a very heavily regulated industry.
Right.
How do you manage that? Because on the one hand, you want to unleash this new technology for benefit for the patient and for efficiency.
Right.
But on the other hand, you've got security and regs to deal with.
Yeah, so you know there are a handful of states who have already come up with AI bills.
Yeah, Colorado, I think.
Yeah, and you know, I know Texas is exploring those right now. Nothing has been finalized, but we know it's coming. You know, there are things from the federal government, and then you think about more broadly, you know, the EU, their AI bills and all those things. So that's why I talk about the secure adoption, because AI is just another application. And so there are traditional security measures that have to go into play there that will, if you, to me, compliance with regulatory requirements becomes a byproduct of doing security right from the beginning.
Yep.
So
from your mouth to God's ears, John.
You know,
if only it wasn't check the box.
Yeah. Yes,
compliance is important, but it's a byproduct of doing the right things from a security standpoint. So if we go through this thinking about what are, you know, there are traditional security measures, but then there are guardrails that you got to have in place, because this is an emerging technology. It's still growing, and it continues to explode in terms of its growth. So you have to continue to evolve the security measures that you put in place to protect the user of the AI so that there is responsible use. You got to be able to detect bias and ensure safety. And, you know, just one quick note on that. When we talk about safety, people automatically think physical safety.
Yeah.
As in, you know, the Waymo cars going around and, you know, is a bad decision and the AI going to get somebody into an accident, right? Yeah, that's part of it. But then there are other measures of safety, you know, mental or psychological safety. You know, harm in terms of, let's say the AI makes a decision that denies me access to care. There's currently a case with the FTC right now being reviewed about a consultancy that built an application that makes decisions on eligibility for Medicaid benefits. Well, when the decision is made, benefits are denied, harm has just been brought about to the person to whom benefits were denied. So.
And with healthcare, you deal with some of the most sensitive things in a person's life.
Absolutely.
You know, I did customer service for mental health and substance abuse for Blue Cross Blue Shield, and we would ask people every time we talked to them, you know, do you think you're going to harm yourself or someone else? And so when you put that question in the hands of AI and expect it to respond appropriately, that's
right.
A lot of risk to take on.
Yes.
You know, with regard, or if someone's having a heart attack and they're chatting with your chatbot and you've got to be able to very quickly tell them, actually, no, you need to get to the emergency room as soon as possible.
Right.
I mean, I think that sometimes we lose touch of the fact that hallucinations might mean a bad answer from ChatGPT for you,
yes.
But when we're talking about people's lives, and it literally has life or death consequences, so
right.
I don't know that your position is enviable.
There are liabilities with that too.
You know, it's definitely not an enviable position, but it's one that I embrace because, you know, I see myself as a protector, whether it's with my family or within the organization that I'm employed by. It's my goal and responsibility is to protect, you know, our stakeholders internally, externally, and those people who depend on the service that we provide. Mm-hmm. So that's why I absolutely love this job. I don't know that I'd want any other job.
It's great.
That's probably why you're so good at it too.
Yeah.
No, thank you.
Hey, John, let me turn this around because we are at RSA. So as a CISO, how much are you looking at AI for security roles, security automation. So, I mean, I've lived in the security operations world for a long time, and sure. we're talking about, well, AI could substitute or at least enhance a level one analyst.
Right.
So, what does that look like in the real world, in your world?
I'll tell you, you know, I think it's a fantastic thing. I think AI can certainly help us operate more efficiently, more effectively. And you know, we currently utilize it in our SIM SOC environment, because what it does is now we don't have to worry about alert fatigue. We don't have to worry about an analyst, you know, being on the 11th hour of a 12-hour shift and they missed a signal that would have indicated, you know, there was an indicator of a compromise that they missed. So now AI can take and leverage threat intelligence to actually find that needle in the haystack a lot sooner than maybe an individual human would be. Or be able to actually, where something might be considered a false positive by the human eye, all of a sudden AI can say, no, this is a true positive and here's why. And identify all of those components, connect the dots that we as humans aren't able to. We're utilizing it to be able to identify leaked compromised credentials on the dark web, and we know those show up every hour on the hour almost, right? So the idea is that once, and it shows up on the dark web as a credential that's compromised in one of these databases, now all of a sudden that's identified as something, a credential from my organization. Now AI takes that threat intel, feeds it into an identity threat detection and response capability, and now it's able to take and trigger Active Directory or your identity provider to disable that account, force a password reset, and then the most beautiful part of it all, ensure that reuse never happens again in the lifetime of that identity.
Yeah, yeah. I think the statistic I read last year was that the average security analyst needs to know 6 query languages to do an investigation.
Oh boy.
And like understanding the difference between KQL, yeah. just all of the different query right. languages, even just that. I mean, I do worry that it'll erode our ability to do those things on our own, but I think there's always room to automate a lot of the crappy parts of our jobs.
You nailed something there when you said erode the ability for us to do things on our own. I think one of the challenges that AI is presenting to the next generation of cyber professionals is critical thinking.
Yeah. I've already seen it.
Yes.
And I see it in myself, like in my car. My car does lane keeping for me. I'm probably not as alert driving my vehicle as I used to be, especially the stretch between Tucson and Phoenix. It's 100% straight. And yeah, I don't know that I'm as alert as I was when I had to drive my own car.
See, I'm watching videos.
I shouldn't admit that.
I've got the video screen there
gosh.
And let the car drive.
Speaking of insurance premiums.
So John, that brings up a good question. You're constantly hiring, we've all talked about, and I've done research on the skills shortage. Are there new skills you're looking for in security professionals that maybe 2 years ago you didn't think about?
Well, yeah, there are. And you know, to me, one of those is the critical thinking skill. Because it is, yes, the candidate can prove that they're logical in their thinking, they're analytical in their thinking. But critical thinking is one of the most key components of being a security practitioner. Mm-hmm. Being able to connect a dot that might otherwise not be, if you aren't thinking about it, if you're just thinking logically and not, my uncle was the police chief in the city of Tampa years ago. And one thing he taught me was to catch a criminal, you got to think like a criminal. Well, their critical thinking ability to think, okay, so if I were a criminal, how would I go about trying to attack this environment? Based on what I know, because we all know environments get scanned all day, every day by the adversaries, right? So they're doing reconnaissance. So as they're picking up what they see are gaps in your security or a way in, they exploit it. So if my security practitioner on my staff is not able to do that and apply critical thinking to think like an attacker, well then, you know, that's the challenge.
Yeah.
But we are now starting to expect that these new practitioners are going to have an understanding of how to utilize AI and how AI could be utilized to in an attack.
So it's almost on the employer to be doing, you know, like CTFs and red team and blue team exercises for fun, you know, 1 day a month, 2 days a month.
Absolutely.
With your team, like keep them on their toes, keep them functioning in an adversarial and defender way so that they really keep those skills sharp.
Couldn't agree with you more.
Yeah. All right, John, thank you so much. This has been a great conversation. This is Jackie McGuire for theCUBE. We are live from RSAC 2025, and we will be back shortly with more insights and information for you. Thank you. Hi, Nerd Fan.